Thank you for joining us. We are very proud to present this special presentation today on breakthroughs in health by the co-founder of Life Extension, Bill Falloon.
Okay, group, as Neil told you, the title of this particular event is very serious because the information I'm going to disseminate may very well save your life or the life of someone you care about. The fact of the matter is, there are some drugs that instead of having detrimental side effects, have incredibly beneficial side benefits. Benefits that exceed their labeled use. In other words, they may be used to dry up some stomach acid and be partially effective, but they have more potent effects when used properly to boost your immune function. And this lecture deals with cancer and aging, and they both go together. A lot of people associate cancer with middle-aged or younger people, because when a young or middle-aged person is stricken with cancer, well, it's a tragedy, and people will raise money, they'll start organizations, they'll really try to do everything they can to spare that younger person. But the fact of the matter is, cancer in people young is relatively rare. And this chart, I wish it was a little bit bigger as far as the print, but it deals with breast cancer risk in women. And up until the age of 25, it's extremely rare. But if you look at that chart, if you can read that, between the age of 25 and 30, there's basically a 4-5-fold increased risk of breast cancer. And every 5 years, the increase spirals upward. So cancer and aging go together for reasons I'm going to explain to you tonight. But if you want to defeat aging and or cancer, you have to defeat both. Because as you can see, if you live to be around the age of 80, your odds of contracting breast cancer are about 1 in 9. So if we can keep you young, wow, we may be able to prevent a whole lot of these malignancies that are killing a lot of people. 1,500 Americans die every single day in this country of cancer. And what frustrates me sometimes is when the media will focus on a violent event where several people are killed or maybe one person is killed, and I keep hoping someday they'll remind the public that 1,500 other people were killed by cancer, and many of those cancer deaths were needless because the medical profession is not incorporating therapies that are proven safe and effective in improving survival. The medical profession is failing to do that. A drug that I've talked about a couple times before, but I'm going to reiterate it tonight. It's so important that people understand cimetidine. Now, the brand name of that was Tagamet, and most of you have seen hundreds, if not thousands, of commercials in the past for Tagamet as a way to dry up excess stomach acid. It's not used as much anymore because the proton pump inhibitor drugs like Prilosec and Prevacid, those are now much more common. Those proton pump inhibitors have serious side effects. So if you suffer from esophageal reflux, you should look at alternatives because the proton pump inhibitors will increase your risk of kidney failure and a host of other degenerative disorders. But cimetidine, that has some unique side benefits that can dramatically improve survival in a wide variety of cancers. It's been studied the most, though, in colon cancer. And here's a study in 1994, and it showed that when cimetidine was introduced preoperatively, which is very important, by the way, when a cancer patient undergoes surgery, their immune system is depressed by virtue of the stress and the trauma and the recovery that occurs by virtue of cancer surgery. So these doctors did something very interesting. They administered cimetidine 7 days before the surgical procedure, and then they did it afterwards. And there was a rather significant improvement in 3-year survival. You look at 93% of these people living after 3 years compared to a far lower number in people not given cimetidine. Now, this is a 1994 study, and here we are 22, 23 years later, and we're talking about it as if it's something new. It's not. It's not new at all. And another study done in 2002 showed that people given cimetidine, 84% of them alive after 10 years, compared to only about 49% who were not given cimetidine. So if you develop a malignancy and you're scheduled for surgery or any other procedure, you should consider getting on about 800 milligrams of cimetidine every night before the surgery and continuing it for about a year afterwards. There's a number of different studies using different protocols. We've tried to put as many of them together, but based on the current findings, you want to have cimetidine in your body before that surgery, before the immune system is suppressed, and you want to keep it there so that you can get some of the benefits of both the immune-boosting drugs that are coming around to become rather popular nowadays, but they can work a lot better if you've got a healthier immune system to begin with, and cimetidine is one of those drugs with significant side benefits, not only against cancer, but against herpes-type infections, shingles outbreaks, warts, HPV warts, all kinds of viral problems can be suppressed with a proper use of cimetidine. It's not something you take every day, by the way, as a dietary supplement. We've been suggesting some people as they grow older maybe take it for the month of December and January. Boost your immune system. It works by three or four different ways to improve immune function, including promoting the release of interleukin-2 that then stimulates your natural killer cells to become very active. It will inhibit the ability of cancer cells to cling on, to adhere to the capillary beds in other parts of the body. The molecule that it inhibits is called E-selectin. It's an adhesion molecule. If you're a cancer patient, well, you don't want high activity of E-selectin, and cimetidine has a really unique way of suppressing that, which is why we feel the survival improvements were so significant. So here we are, year 2017, and I'm giving a talk about a drug that was shown effective back in 1985. That long ago was published information indicating cimetidine might be effective. And we had doctors back in 1984, 85, using cimetidine on their patients, getting the results that I'm talking about. But there was no way to disseminate that information. I wanted to get information out to people, information that they would remember when a disease strikes them. This is very, very significant. Now, colon cancer death rates have declined somewhat. And a major reason is more people are getting colonoscopies. They're catching the colon cancer at such an early stage. It's curable often by the colonoscopy procedure itself when they remove the polyps, which are often pre-malignant lesions that eventually turn into colon cancer. But we still have 50,000 Americans dying every single year of colon cancer, and we've got a drug that could slash those death rates rather dramatically, and yet virtually no one knows about it. And the reason is, well, the FDA does not allow a company that sells cimetidine to tell you that it works. I can tell you because I don't sell it, but a company who sells cimetidine can't do it, so there's not going to be any promotion to oncologists who would likely advise their patients. It really means you've got to advise yourself. You've got to recall the scientific literature can provide lots of data for you to look at if you contract a disease. And if you don't pay attention to what's in the published literature, you're not going to get access to a drug like cimetidine. Very safe, very effective. Metformin. I've been talking about it since year 1995. And it's unbelievable that this drug has so many anti-aging properties and anti-cancer properties, and yet it's not being effectively utilized for both disease prevention, slowing aging, preventing and treating cancer, and potentially treating or preventing virtually every degenerative illness out there. Metformin. Diabetics are getting it right now. Enlightened individuals are taking metformin because they understand it has some tremendous benefits, mainly in the area of cancer prevention and cancer treatment. I'm going to explain how that works during this meeting so that you understand why you want to have metformin in your body. But going back to that previous slide, to think that that was approved in 1958 in England, and we had to wait as Americans until 1995 to legally gain access to it. And here we are in 2017, and it's illegal for the metformin manufacturer to tell you this is a good adjuvant cancer treatment, or this is a good way to reduce your risk of contracting cancer. It's somewhat absurd. These are just a few of the hundreds of published studies that validate the anti-cancer properties of metformin. If you type in metformin and cancer on the National Library of Medicine's database, you'll see hundreds and hundreds of studies validating its efficacy. The study that impressed us most was done at MD Anderson Cancer Center, and they found that pancreatic cancer patients who were taking metformin, or if they were taking metformin, they had a 62% lower risk of contracting pancreatic cancer. And we've used metformin in the adjuvant treatment of pancreatic cancer and gotten some rather remarkable survival results. So here we have a drug that could help the 45,000 Americans a year who are stricken with pancreatic cancer, about 41,000 die. It's one of those cancers that's virtually incurable. We have an effective medication that could help at least improve survival. The information's covered up. This is really regrettable because we've got all of this data. It's in the published scientific literature. It's available on everyone's iPhone, everyone's laptop. It's not like you have to go down to the University of Miami Medical Library anymore and spend a day looking for it. It's right at your fingertips, and yet it's being ignored. A 37-year delay in diabetics gaining access to metformin, and right now we're looking at probably a more than a 50-year delay before the FDA ever approves it as an anti-cancer medication. Got to change that regulatory system. We've got a duty to share information that can save human lives. This is our doctrine, disseminating peer-reviewed published information and anecdotal findings. Anecdotal information can be helpful too to lead us in a direction that will eventually result and mankind transforming into an environment of perpetual existence. Now, as it relates to pancreatic cancer treatment, if you're diagnosed with this disease, some people opt to do nothing. They opt to die because the treatments are not particularly effective. The surgical therapy is called a Whipple procedure. It was developed in the 1930s, and it's like being autopsied alive. They don't just take out your pancreas, they take out part of your stomach, esophagus, spleen, liver. It is a horrific procedure to have to go through, and the survival rates are very low. However, if you have interleukin-2 put in your body just 3 days before you undergo that horrific Whipple procedure, look at the survival benefits that occur with a drug that was approved back in the 1970s. And by itself, it's not a cancer cure. It doesn't work by itself to cure cancer. But if you administer the interleukin-2 and your doctor has to prescribe this 3 days before the surgery, your odds of living 2 years, 3 years later are significantly enhanced. And what's really important is the complications. Whipple procedure patients often spend weeks in a hospital with all kind of tubes draining fluid from different parts of their body that have been removed. But you cut down those surgical complications dramatically simply by using an FDA-approved drug in a creative way. And that's what interleukin-2 is all about. Now, we've been disseminating this information for a couple years now, and we've yet heard of a single pancreatic cancer patient who calls us after everything fails. We ask them, well, did your oncologist prescribe interleukin-2 before the procedure? And we've never heard a single oncologist do this, despite it being published in a respected peer-reviewed medical journal. So the topic of this conversation is using FDA-approved drugs for unapproved uses or off-label uses. It's legal to do. Doctors can legally prescribe these drugs. It is illegal, however, for the manufacturer of those drugs to disseminate that information. And this is why we need to abolish the Food and Drug Administration. They are standing in the way of people gaining access to life-saving medications, life-saving therapies to both prevent and treat degenerative illness. We can't get our hands on this, for the most part, we meaning the public, you all in this church can, because you're learning about it right now. And I like to reference anything I say, and I will be doing that with every single slide. You can find the journal reference, you can read the published study yourself, you can see just how effective these therapies can be in suppressing cancer. Now, we're getting lots and lots of good publicity about human age reversal. The Economist is a widely read magazine, very upscale, very dense reading for people who want to learn nitty-gritty details about making lots and lots of money. Well, they did a study, a story recently about using young human plasma to reverse aging in older individuals. The fact that young plasma can rejuvenate older people. There's a lot of data to validate that in the animal model, and it's so persuasive, people are going out right now and purchasing young human plasma and putting it into their body. Based on stories like this in The Economist and many, many stories we have written about it in publications that I'm involved in and many other media sources. Wall Street Journal, these are all recent news media reports, by the way. Wall Street Journal earlier this month talked about a drug called rapamycin. Rapamycin, by the way, may be a super metformin in the way it works. I'm going to describe that to you in just a minute. But what's happening is a group in San Francisco has formed the Young Dog Project, and they're giving rapamycin to old dogs. And from what we've heard so far, they're getting some really nice results in reversing aging in old dogs. And it's really time for people to start considering using the proper dose of rapamycin. And we learned what may be the proper dose via interactions, people talking to each other, exchanging information. We ran across a pioneering doctor up in Long Island, New York, who's using rapamycin to treat virtually every one of his aging patients, and he's getting some really nice results. Okay, these are the human age reversal projects that we are most excited about. Rapamycin is included in there, but so are a whole lot of other technologies. The NAD age reversal studies have already been done. The outcomes have been quite favorable. I just got a text, by the way, today, a couple hours ago, from one of our members up in Connecticut, and he was hooked up to an IV having NAD dripped into his body for the purpose of hopefully improving his heart function. He has some congestive heart failure and reversing his aging process. But these are the projects that we are most excited about as it relates to reversing human aging. And the great news is a study on senolytics, that's the dasatinib quercetin up there, the one up from the bottom, purged senescent cells with dasatinib quercetin. Those studies are almost complete in people. Wall Street Journal was talking about it's time to start doing some of these studies. Well, right now there are individuals who are initiating these studies. And again, rapamycin, it's extended the lifespan in virtually every species it's ever been tested in. The improvements are systemic, which is critical. If we rejuvenate your kidneys, it doesn't do you much good if your heart, lungs, or brain are not functioning. So there's systemic improvements and reduced rates of cancer, improved cardiac function. Rapamycin looks like a drug that we may start to advocate very, very soon. And right just about a year ago, Science Daily reported on a study that then got picked up by CNN about the fact that when you give rapamycin to old mice, well, they live about 60% longer. So I may be starting on rapamycin relatively soon. As far as how it works, this is what fascinates me. It directly turns down a macrolide protein that exists in all of our cells called mTOR. mTOR stands for the mechanistic target of rapamycin. And by turning that down, a number of beneficial results occur, including turning on autophagy. Autophagy is a normal process that occurs in our youth in which we rid our cells of accumulated metabolic waste products. Aubrey de Grey refers to this as cellular junk, and we want to get rid of it. And as long as we have high levels of mTOR, which are going to occur if we continue to over-ingest calories, well, we're not going to clear out our aged cells. They're going to clog up. Our delicate cell machinery will clog up until we no longer function. But the rapamycin does a lot more than that. It improves bone marrow function. It helps metabolize fat stores. We're hoping it enables people to lose a lot of weight around their abdominal area. It's extended, again, lifespan in virtually every species it's been tested in, and it improves bone marrow function, something very, very important as people grow older. So we love these mechanisms. Now, most people here are doing something to suppress mTOR indirectly by boosting AMPK, adenosine monophosphate activated protein kinase. AMPK is an enzyme that is in our cells, but it's at very low levels because most of us overeat. We overconsume calories that suppresses AMPK. Ways to boost AMPK, the drug metformin, green tea, curcumin, gynostema pentaphyllum, resveratrol, these all help boost AMPK. But rapamycin directly inhibits the mTOR pathway, and that's why we're getting more excited about rapamycin right now than metformin. Though the protocol that you're going to learn about, it involves both rapamycin and metformin being used simultaneously. Because once you understand how important it is to both boost AMPK and suppress mTOR, you understand we're on the verge of a revolution as to how long people will live and how healthy they're going to live. And again, the mTOR, by it not being suppressed, results in excess fat accumulation. It results in insulin resistance, diabetes, chronic inflammation. AMPK activates some signals in a way that they suppress mTOR, but they don't do it directly. We like rapamycin because it's a direct way of inactivating mTOR pathways. Now, you may wonder, here we have something that's excessive in most of our bodies, and it contributes to all of these degenerative illnesses, atherosclerosis, cancer, accelerated aging, insulin resistance, dementia. All of these problems are connected to excess levels of mTOR, the mechanistic target of rapamycin. And you may wonder, well, what do we have this in our body for? Look at what it does to us. I mean, it's accelerating aging. It contributes to age-related diseases. And by the way, when you go home tonight, if you don't want to watch something on TV, just type in mTOR and aging onto the National Library of Medicine website. That's pubmed.gov. You'll see hundreds of papers by independent scientists talking about, here is a way that we can slow down age-related disease and maybe even reverse it. People with congestive heart failure, they may be getting some tremendous benefits once rapamycin starts to be used. And because the FDA does not allow the maker of rapamycin to make a claim that it could be effective against congestive heart failure, well, we remain in the dark unless we attend events like this where we can freely disseminate truthful scientific information that we fully reference. So you can read the whole study and see what kind of conclusions. But these are remarkable benefits. And you figure there's 5 million people in this country with congestive heart failure, and there's a drug right now that could reverse that, and yet it's not being used. As it relates to prostate cancer and many other malignancies, you want to suppress mTOR. Any cancer patient, by the way, should take some step to reduce their mTOR levels, which is why metformin is probably working so well, because metformin indirectly suppresses mTOR. Rapamycin does it directly, and we like that a lot. And this is a particular disease that's not common, mantle cell lymphoma, but it's very lethal, and there's not a real effective therapy that consistently works. Well, there's some preliminary research showing that an mTOR inhibitor and another drug, a tyrosine kinase inhibitor, together may be effective in treating this. Have them look into this data, because these drugs are available right now. These drugs don't have to be discovered. They don't have to be approved. Your oncologist simply has to prescribe them. And if he doesn't prescribe them, I suggest you get another oncologist. Don't let yourself die while your doctor fails to prescribe drugs that are already demonstrated in the published literature to show efficacy. This study came out just a couple weeks ago. Metformin, therapeutic effects against colon cancer. And again, one of the benefits of metformin is that it indirectly suppresses mTOR. It also lowers glucose and insulin in the blood. But you look at the survival benefits of patients given metformin compared to the non-metformin patients. These are huge, huge benefits. And anyone who contracts cancer, who says, I don't want to take metformin because it's a diabetic drug, it's not approved for cancer, you're missing out on a heck of a lot, because this is hardcore published data, though there is a caveat. Some of these patients who were not on metformin may have been using the sulfonylurea drugs or insulin, and that would promote cancer growth. But nonetheless, this data was published, and we believe it further substantiates the benefit of suppressing mTOR using metformin and rapamycin. We'd like to suppress it as much as we can. Again, huge benefits, suppressing something that most people don't even know exists in their cells, but it is there. And when you suppress mTOR, you could potentially lose weight, and maybe that will be the way we break through as it relates to the apathy, as it relates to aging reversal. If people start to lose weight, they may accidentally just start taking mTOR inhibitors. If you wonder why we have all this in our body, the mTOR, well, we needed it to reproduce. mTOR promotes rapid proliferation of our cells. And when we were created, we needed rapid cellular proliferation. Without it, we never would have survived in our mother's womb. And this extended all the way through the embryonic fetal period, all the way up into early adulthood. We needed lots and lots of mTOR. Well, guess what? We've grown up. We don't need excessive cellular proliferation anymore. And yet we consume calories as if we're a rapidly growing child. And the result is abdominal obesity, obesity in general. And this is all related in many respects to excess mTOR activity that can be suppressed with rapamycin. Study done, published December 24th, 2014. They used an mTOR inhibitor, which rapamycin is, in elderly people, and they were able to improve immune function. Another benefit to rapamycin: your body becomes more sensitive to insulin, you lose weight, your cancer risk goes down, your immune function improves, your lifespan is extended. Lots and lots of benefits to suppressing mTOR. And the way that you can be kept up to date is to register on the rescueelders.org website. So this website is something that you all should be registered on, because if you register, that's going to stay, but we're going to make it much more interactive, much more robust as far as the forums. We're going to be communicating information back and forth. We're going to figure out a way to defeat aging and death as fast as it can possibly be done, and we're doing it by taking away the financial incentives. The financial incentives, unfortunately, are causing people to spend years filing for patents, negotiating business deals, and more delays in getting FDA approval. None of us in this room can really wait that long. Even some of the younger people can't wait that long for the FDA to approve of what we need to do. We need to do it ourselves, just like the Society for the Rescue of Drowned Persons did in Amsterdam in 1767. They brought dead people back to life. We are determined to enable older people to grow biologically younger.